Hello.
Hi.
Hi, welcome. I'm Amy Kennedy from the Kennedy Forum, and I'm so glad you could be here today with us. I was also a teacher, so I'll be really excited to hear what some of the people on our panel have to say about their experiences in the classroom. I was a teacher in New Jersey. I worked in a public school there in Northfield, New Jersey for almost 15 years. And in my time teaching, I had very little training when it came to mental health issues that were facing my students. I really struggled with how to best serve the students that were in my classroom. I often, when I started, was at a loss and found myself escalating situations with my students rather than having the tools that I needed to de-escalate a situation, let alone provide them help, support, and navigate a system with them where they could find some resources both for themselves and their families. It was not until I was leaving the profession of teaching and joining Patrick in his efforts with mental health that I learn more about how I could have been using this in my classroom, not just techniques, but also a shift in the way that I saw the students in my room. A lot of it for me since leaving Northfield schools has been a transition in my thinking. And we will talk about today how there's really a major shift needed in the culture and our approach to students. But for me, it was going from seeing students that were struggling as that they didn't care, that they weren't motivated, that they had bad behavior, to seeing that as signs that they needed interventions. So that change for me happened too late, and I'm really hopeful that as we keep having these conversations, that we're going to increase awareness for other teachers and other support staff in the school and for parents so that they can be advocating for the best supports in the school for their children. So I'm really excited today to have with us Laura Bay, who is both the president of the National PTA as well as a teacher, a parent, and an administrator of assessment and instruction. In addition, we have James Pearlman, who's a counselor, a mental health first aid trainer, and a parent, and Corey Burnette, who is a teacher. Maybe you could each start, and we'll just go down the line, if that's okay, and you could give us a little bit more background of your teaching and how you got interested in mental health that we're talking about today. Corey, you want to start?
I'll go first. Okay, yeah. Fine. Again, Corey Burnette. I'm from originally from Chicago, Illinois. Of course, my path to Ohio was quite short. Quite quick, if anything. Graduated school system in Chicago, Inglewood, that is. So if you know all about the crime situation, I'm part of that as far as the upbringing. Graduated Chicago City Schools, went to HBCU in Ohio, Central State University. Graduated there, went to the nearby high school with the community school, which is Xeria. And I've been there for 20 years, just completed my 20 year as an intervention specialist there, 9th grade through 12. Again, experiences as far as being involved with mental health. I got involved through my wife and her co-worker, Jan Cox. My wife is Rochelle Burnette. They are both mental health trainers. Real simple with me, it started off with bedroom talk, pillow talk. She's telling me about everything about mental health, and you know how just trying to go to sleep. One thing led to another, I'm in the session. And from there, it took off. I fell crazy in love with it. We did everything. We're still doing everything we're trying to do to implement it in our school system. Stop right there.
Hi, I'm Laura Bay. I am here with a variety, I've arrived here through a variety of pathways. I am from Bremerton, Washington, so if any of you are here in Seattle, oh, there we go, someone from Bremerton, good. King County, okay. So it's an hour ferry ride away, Title I district. I started there as a parent. My kids went to school at an elementary school there. As they went through the school, I decided, besides doing PTA, I thought, what else can I add to my plate? And I decided to go seek a second career to become a teacher. And so while they were in middle school, I went and got my certificate, and I had been part of the school system in Bremerton for quite a few years, kind of one of those stalwart volunteers that were there doing building school needs, community needs, and also district needs. And so then I started teaching. And similar to Amy, as the kids came into my classroom, I realized, and I knew before, that it wasn't just about teaching the academics. It was also meeting their cognitive needs, their emotional needs, their social needs. And that being in a Title I district with a high level of poverty and homelessness, that there were a lot of stressors on both families and kids, and that put stressors again on the school system to help us all meet those things so that the kids were ready to learn. They came to school to learn, but whatever happened last night or last week or the week before became part of who they were when they walked in that classroom. And some of them could leave it every day or just about every day at the door as they entered my classroom, and some of them couldn't. And that just, we had to wrap ourselves as a teacher, as teachers and as school cultures, as parents in a community on how to make help and how to help them access what they needed so that they could then sit down and get out their paper and open the book and start working in groups, because learning right now has changed a lot. And so it's just not sit and be quiet and not squirm, as many of us learned in the system. It was how to work in groups, too. So you needed those social-emotional tools, right? So that was my first experience about not necessarily mental health, but about social-emotional learning behaviors and how that plays into both the school system and into community. So I continued with my PTA work and eventually became part of National PTA, the Board of Directors, and now I'm their president for this 2 years. It'll end in June. And we have become really involved at National PTA, 120 years this year of advocating for making sure every single child's potential is a reality in their homes, in their communities, and in their lives. And when we do that at National PTA as a group of volunteers, we want to make sure they have everything they need to be successful in their schools and in their communities. And it involves supporting learning, wellness, safety, mental health issues, physical needs, and curriculum. So that's part of where I'm at. And I'm going to share in a little bit that we have position statements and resolutions. We're active in making sure that we meet the needs of children where they're at, both trauma-informed care and early identification and intervention for children with mental health needs. The last thing I'm going to share is, as my son, oldest son, became a teenager, I realized that there were some behaviors that I'm going to share that I kind of worried about. How many of you have had teenagers in your house and you know the warning signs of skipping classes, not getting out of bed, angry, compulsive, not knowing where they're at, blowing out, and we think, oh my God, my child is now into drugs. Mm-hmm. My child developed schizoaffective bipolar disorder. All of a sudden, it became something that moved a child who was an honor student, who was an athlete, into a whole new world. We had to identify that challenge and talk about mental health with the teachers I was teaching with in the community I was raised in a very real way, as this adolescent teenager developed bipolar. Didn't develop it, unfolded in front of us. So I'm a parent who has an adult child who's disabled by a mental health issue. I still work in a school district. I work in the district office now and not in the classroom because I travel and do National PTA part-time and my other job the other part of the time. And I'm here to share what I see in my classroom, in my district, and in my life, and the importance of community. Resources, a social support system that embraces counselors, mental health professionals, teachers, law enforcement, so that we wrap ourselves around the children in the family who have mental health issues early. And we all can identify it in our school systems so that we can make sure we're creating every child's potential and their reality becoming something in their lives. Thanks, Laura.
Dan. My name is James Pearlman. Sorry for my allergetic voice. I'm from Santa Fe, New Mexico, where I'm a high school guidance counselor. My journey is a little bit more roundabout. It took me longer to get there. I graduated high school, went to college, went to become a teacher. When I finished, I joined AmeriCorps, National Civilian Community Corps. The time we were based in San Diego, one of my projects was actually down the road in Vaughan, Washington, helping out with the Camp Easter Seals. When I finished my 2 years with AmeriCorps, my wife and I moved to Denver. There I dabbled in this and that, but eventually was working with youth again, and then moved again to Sacramento, where I was working in Job Corps. And it was while I was at Job Corps that I really started seeing what barriers there were and what effects there were for youth who were not getting the services they needed and going undiagnosed. I was there for 3 years before eventually moving back to Santa Fe, New Mexico, where then I pursued my master's degree in counseling. I found I had a knack for working with youth, connecting with youth, and there was no place I wanted to do that more than at my old high school where there had been somebody to help me. So I eventually, while I was doing it, I worked for some different agencies. Also worked in a residential treatment house for young boys, 12 to 18. So when I finished my master's, I was lucky enough to go right into my old high school and start working. And we're fortunate enough that we have clinical counselors as well there. But being there and seeing this, it's really brought it. I've tried to bring it to the forefront in my district. I really got involved because my wife, Suzanne, was in charge of, in the state, of getting mental health first aid out to agencies, to the police, to anybody who would take it. They had grants, and she was in charge of pushing it out, and a lot of pillow talk.
Right.
So it became my part of my passion as well. My school has a lot of other issues that I'm passionate about, but that is definitely one of them. And so being in those trainings, I've done the adult and I've done the youth trainings for mental health first aid. I've also been trained in trauma first aid. And so my goal right now is to push more and more to have our district, have everybody in the district end up being trained. And that's where I am now.
Thanks. Well, I think we see a theme here emerging of the women in your lives pushing you and mandating this as the path forward. So we are faced with a wide range of responsibilities that go far beyond academic achievement. And we know that mental health issues are increasing, with 1 in 5 students suffering from a mental health disorder, 80% of serious mental illnesses being diagnosed in childhood. What are some of the stressors that you're seeing today that are maybe bringing this to the forefront? What does it look like right now in your classroom, in your school, that you're seeing as kind of the dynamic in your building right now?
I can start off with, you figure with the Xenia School District or the Xenia Community School District, I would say maybe 3 years ago, we had an extremely high suspension rate. By the time we broke all that down, broke the data down, why the kids were getting suspended, it came down to, again, just the basic problems at home, not understanding them, not listening to them. And, you know, again, that promoted some form of, okay, what do we do to help them? And again, from my standpoint, that's where it started from. I was in the classroom for 20 years. And like I said, maybe the last 4 years I have took on the role as in-school intervention. Okay, I think of different sides of the world, we call it ISI. Again, we started that off as just a means of preventing or reducing suspension rates. Before you know it, I have a wide variety of students in my in-school room, in my ISI room. Before you know it, you build relationships, you start talking. A lot of it is things at home. A lot of it's things at home, the stress of trying to pass on to the next level on top of being a teenager. A lot of their, I don't want to say issues, comes from, it could be anything drug-related at home, financial. Of course, they bring those issues to the classroom, and as a teacher, it's been extremely hard just trying to decipher what is it. Is it just a kid being a kid, a teenager, or those underlying problems?
That's a really good point. That's, I think, for a lot of us, a big struggle, because when we're talking about middle school or high schoolers, how much of it is this just a normal part of their behavior change because they're starting to show some independence? Or when do we know that this is more than that? Or maybe, as you suggested, with drug use at home or poverty, that this might be a situation where ACE, adverse childhood experiences, are starting to impact their learning.
I think I remember back when I first started teaching, the most common stressors were sometimes poverty, sometimes job changes. It was 12, 13 years ago, and there was a lot of stress on the economy. Some of it is about abuse at home, or sometimes it's in the community that they're at. Right? And so it doesn't have to be firsthand experience to be an adverse childhood experience in ACE. It can also be an experience within the community that's observed that creates the trauma. I think a lot of times it is a death in the family or an illness in a family. I remember I was teaching 1 year in a gifted program, and one of the students who was very, very creative, very inspired, was a leader in the classroom. All of a sudden, his behavior changed. His caregiver, his grandmother, was suffering from cancer. So, of course, that also then became a stressor. You had to unpeel the layers to gradually find out what was going on. So these adverse child experiences are very important. Students, when you think of gender identity and teenagers and what they're going through, bullying, because of not looking the same, not having the same clothes or the same experiences when you're coming from poverty. It transcends gender, ethnicity, race, social economic status. It covers things like illnesses, changes in the family structure, uncertainty in the community, and I'm going to talk about one. If you remember the Colorado theater shootings, Sandy Hook, those things that happen in our communities, whether it's the community that we live in or the community that's within our state or a community that's across the country, those create stressors and triggers for kids in very different ways. So we need to be open to what's happening, and teachers and educators and those of us in the school system as counselors or administrators, we need to be aware that we're not looking for just what is the, and I'm going to be blunt, dysfunction in the family setting, and what is coming from within and without or from the outside and impacting that. And sometimes it's not one thing. It's three or four things layered onto that child's experience or that family's experience that creates the trauma that all of a sudden transcends coming to school cognitively, academically, physically, and emotionally ready to learn. And I think that that's what we're facing today. It's not one thing, it's two, three, and four things. And it's that tipping point, if you will.
I agree. With the population that I have at my school, It's all those things, plus the fear of being deported and families being torn apart.
Yeah, I was mentioning that.
I have a large population of my high school is, not U.S. citizens. And we had a huge spike the day after the election in fights, people being afraid, people arguing, not so much physical fights, but loud fights in the classroom, in the hallways. People were very tense. And our district has done a good job at calming people down, letting them know that our school is a safe place to be. But it is yet another layer that we're trying to deal with in having our students, another barrier that we have to get through to get our students to sit down and learn. Besides the poverty, besides them worrying about where they're going to get their next meal, they're worried about dad being deported, mom being deported. They might be a citizen or their siblings. I've got a lot of dreamers as well, and a lot of things are in flux right now, which has just created another very big barrier for them to get educated, let us help them so that they can move on.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, that is a big piece right now. And as you pointed out, it is a climate that's not necessarily within a family dynamic. It could be in the community that's an issue, or politically what's happening that might be. It was interesting to me when you brought up the different tragedies that we've talked about before. I thought, my school's response to that, as I know all schools, was to train us in lockdown procedures.
Alex training.
So we have regularly as we're doing our fire drills, we have lockdown training of where to hide in the classroom, how to close the blinds and lock the door. What we didn't have was the mental health first aid training. Mm-hmm. Right? So it's reactive instead of preventative or early intervention. And I thought that, being as you are both, James and Corey, working in mental health first aid, how you see that could be an opportunity there, where you've been able to use that, and how are people in your building receptive to that? You want to start, Corey?
Receptive. Right now, we have a small population in our community, well, in our school district, that is receptive in as far as bringing on National Council, bringing on the concept of understanding our kids. Before, it was just strictly trying to get professional development on their subject matter, period. And again, before I became the ISI coordinator, I was that same individual as well. 9th and 10th grade U.S. history teacher. So of course, any and everything that deals with history, professional development, that's what I'm going towards because one, I want that reinforcement, I want the education. Two, I know it's going to go towards my step as far as making more pay. Okay. And three, it's based on evaluation process for me to come on for the next year or 5 years as far as my contract. So again, when it really came down to mental health, wasn't even discussed. And so like I said, right now I'm just trying to push it just to say, hey, let's look at this in the beginning of the year for all teachers, especially our young ones that's coming in.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. I think that correlation hasn't really been identified yet between the teacher seeing the benefit of mental health in their evaluations, in the assessment of their own effective teaching. So how is it going to enhance their teaching to have this as a fundamental piece? How have you seen it received in your...
It has... I've been pushing, and I'm just a counselor in a decent-sized district, and I've been probing and trying to find out who would listen to me about getting it, because I know I had this great opportunity, and it was just a matter of time and who was willing. The biggest barrier is a teacher's their time, their schedule, their contract time, and there are not that many in-service days or professional development days. But I was able finally through, as we had turnover, found somebody who was willing to listen And slowly, so we got our foot in the door, and a few months ago, we got every counselor in the district to be trained in mental health first aid with the youth curriculum. So that was a big, was
that
a big deal.
That sounds like common sense, James.
It does, right. Well, it is, but for most of us counselors, it's a lot of review. A lot of the stuff in there, we know. But at least it was a way to get us, the district and the staff in the district, a foot in the door, because what we really want to have is the teachers and the administrators trained in it.
Correct.
Most of us counselors, it was great information. It was a lot of great review, but we knew that most of it already.
Right.
And so, but it was great to get our foot in the door. And now I'm working with the counseling coordinator and trying to push through so that at the beginning of the year, when we do have that time for professional development, to get all our, at least all our high school teachers trained in the mental health first aid youth curriculum. Mm-hmm. So, but we have our foot in the door, and now people are hearing about it more in our district. Hopefully it'll be, they'll see it more and get the buzz, and then hopefully that'll help launch it to everybody else.
Yeah, we're at National Council, but it's not just mental health first aid. What do you see as, in your school, Laura, kind of the attitude in general towards mental health?
So I think what I see is, as teachers come on board and as we talk about the teaching profession, we get coursework in behavior management. Okay, and I see people nodding their heads. The fallacy with that is if you're trying to manage the behavior, it runs away from you, right? Because the more you try to manage, any of you raised teenagers, the more you tried to manage them, the less successful you were. Okay, so that's like that in the classroom. I like to do analogies, right? The more you try to manage the behavior, am I going to pick this method or this method? Am I going to have the straws or the stars or the whatever the trick is, you get behind it, right? And all of a sudden it becomes, it eats away at your time. And so to get back to your question is, how do we deal with mental health? Well, number one, we have to quit trying to manage the behavior. And that's what I think this forum, this conference is all about, is understanding what's behind what we're seeing. The behavior is a manifestation of whatever the stressors or the conditions are that have created that, the behaviors within that child's life and within your classroom and what you're trying to achieve. And so as a new teacher 17 years ago, as a second profession, I was fortunate to be in a school that wanted to unwrap and create a climate that made sure every child had an opportunity to be successful in their learning at that school. And that learning wasn't about academics, it was how to be an adult when they went through the K-12 system in the Bremerton School District. So it was an outcome, right? And so as we did that, we realized we couldn't manage the behavior. We had to understand the underlying causes. And I'm gonna tell you, there's not a lot of resources in service time. How do you deliver it? We did things like teachers got together and picked a book to do a book study. We're a poverty district. At the time, we picked Eric Jensen's Teaching with Poverty in the Mind, trying to understand what our kids came with. You know, we would reach out and do, and I'm going to throw out buzzwords, RTI, Response to Intervention, or PBIS, or CASEL, or Habit of the Mind. We spent a lot of time as a collective group of teachers, and so did the district, in offering opportunities for us to learn. But the learning was about an event, or a conference, or a workshop, or a book study, and part of you, what you run into, I think all of us run into, then there's no time to implement, yes, tweak, adjust, unpack, reflect. We have a system that makes us be reactive. We need a system in our, I'm going to be bold, in our country, in our states, in our districts, that isn't grant funded to do any program, but is systemic enough so that we, as both a school community and a larger community, can support what's going on and not manage it. And so that's kind of my plea here, is somehow we band together to figure out how to do that around mental health and around the importance of social emotional learning being as important as the standards around reading, ELA, math, science, or even social studies, and making sure that we we've had time to mix and mingle, and how we do that in a meaningful way. I think every teacher, every educator, every counselor, every superintendent, every principal, every community member wants that. It's how do we deliver on something that is a shoestring, a Band-Aid, and it's not a system. And so that's what I think we're here to share. I can tell you how I became the teacher that got the behavior kids in a very successful way. Part of it's my personality. Part of it is raising kids. Part of it was just life experiences that taught me I couldn't manage a behavior.
I think we're talking a lot about sustainability here. How do we have a program that then we can keep going if it's not just grant-based? And also, how do we embed this into kind of all parts of not just the community culture, but the school and what we're doing? What are the missed opportunities in health class and science class and the school nurse's office? And what are the missed opportunities in our first teacher orientations? And so maybe you want to just comment on ways that your school's being innovative or creative in trying to, if they're doing anything to embed that in other ways. We've heard so much about the benefits of early education, pre-K, or after school care. Are there any things that your schools are doing that maybe are coming at it from another angle instead of just saying, let's provide more mental health care, but let's do this in a way that people feel comfortable with? You want to go ahead?
One of the major barriers is the stigma behind it, and breaking down, making it a safe place, bringing it up in casual conversation, bringing the message that it's okay to talk about it is the first step. And it's a big campaign, and for us, it's just starting, but trying to get it out there so that eventually people will talk about it as if it's anything, as if it's as normal as bringing up your math scores, getting enough sleep, making sure that they're taken care of and that they understand that if something's going on, it's okay to talk about it. They don't have to go hide and let it get worse until it explodes, and then it's then it's a crisis. But that's where we're starting. We're in the infancy, but getting the word out and breaking down those barriers to make it okay, to make it not taboo to talk about mental health, or somebody, you see somebody having a problem and turning a blind eye.
We've had some kids initiate this in some of the school districts where it's really, you know, they've started an organization because they were struggling and they wanted support, and shouldn't we have a day or a fair or an after-school program or a parent who had lost a child? So we've seen a little bit about that. I have to be honest, when you say talk about it, that as a teacher in the classroom, I was really uncomfortable bringing up these issues. I didn't want to feel like I was judging a family. So that maybe I was concerned that it was something that was happening at home that was impacting their learning, but I didn't want to be the one judging their parenting or what was happening. And that's really not what it was about. But I didn't know the language to have that conversation. So I would turn to the guidance counselor, who already had so much to do with state testing. Now they've become our state testing administrators. I don't know if that's been the case in your school, James.
It's not the case in my school. My district has been trying to adopt the ASCA model, which takes those sort of responsibilities away from the counselors and distributes them more amongst all teachers. And the counselors will do their part in helping with it, but we're not then just the person at lunch duty and the person that has to administer all the state testing, fortunately, so we are able to do a lot more like that.
Yeah. I'm my counselors, they are 100% test preparation. Mm. And again, when they're 100% test preparation, that leaves no room for what's going on. Can you give me any advice on handling Johnny? Okay. Well, their response could very well be, well, send them to the office and let the principals deal with them. Which, as a result, they will come down to me, because sometimes the principal's trying to be, again, proactive, trying to decrease suspensions. They might send them to me for a day or two. Now, in there, that's when we're trying to do some form of mediation, intervention, just trying to figure out what's going on in a kid's life.
Yeah, I think the idea of a counselor is a little bit of, you know, I think oftentimes parents feel like if there's a problem, the school counselor will let us know, and don't realize that's not a reality in many schools. You want to tell us about your school situation?
So there's a couple things that I want to brag about that Bremerton does well as a title or a poverty school district. We have interventionists at each of our schools. And so at elementary school and then counseling at the high school. And they are there to do the behavior, to help with maybe course graduation in high school is as close as they get to actually being more academic than proactive with behaviors and stuff. But we have them at our schools. And then we also have coaches, instructional coaches at each of our elementary buildings. And so then they get the brunt of being the test coordinators, because that kind of attaches to instruction, right? We also have a model that we've tried the last couple years for partnering with Kitsap Mental Health, which is our community health organization, so that when we see high-flying kids that are really, all of a sudden, things have been clicking and they're not clicking for a kid, and it's in a big way that it's not working in the school, not just in the classroom, but in the school. We have a way to partner and offer services through with mental health professionals teaming with the teachers to do a pull-out model for only a month or two or three that the kid needs to help get services, to help maybe with this early intervention, this is elementary, diagnosis, working with the mental health professionals, working in a small group setting with those kids, with the end result that they get back into the classroom and also get academic learning as much as they can during this time to get them back into the classroom in a quick model. It's an expensive model. It's grant funded for us right now, and as grant funds come and go, the model will have to change and shift. That's the sad part. We could probably all share, and you guys could probably share, successful models that have worked for a time because there have been grant and there's been people who have volunteered off the clock to try to make it work. And I think that that's what we need to know what works, but we also need to know how we can transfer that model into a sustainable model that will help all of us. But that's what we try to do at Bremerton in a very creative way with a poverty district, and trying to put the resources in the right place. That works for us. Is it solving a lot of the issues? Some. Is it the best way to do it? Nope, we need a lot more.
Maybe you could tell us a little bit more about what intervention looks like rather than suspension, in-school suspension, because we know that there's a real correlation between out-of-school placements and suspension and incarceration. If we're doing this intervention early, what ideally would that look like, or what's it look like in your school?
In my school, it pretty much, it's me. I'm the intervention. I mean, I hate to sound blunt, but I am the intervention. Mm-hmm. A lot of the teachers, if they cannot deal with a particular behavior, again, what's the teacher's mistake? Call security, call the principal, principal come get them, they write them up, they will either suspend them or they will come to me. Again, since we're decreasing suspensions, they come to me, the majority of them. Mm-hmm. In my room, I decide. I can sit back and say, okay, we're going to have you, since you're going to be in here for two or three days, three periods at the time, we're just going to focus on you. Mm-hmm. You might just do basic things, a self-talk, or one-on-ones, or just, again, reflect on your feelings. I use a social program called Ripple Effect. I was introduced to it 2 years ago. Absolutely love it. Again, it helps me provide interventions to kids, or to students. To students. These students range from 15 to 19 years old. You already know there are times, there's some things you could talk to them about. If you have that 19-year-old with a kid, you already know there are certain things you can and cannot talk to that kid about. Mm-hmm. So again, the interventions change based on the type of kid. By me being in a small district, it's mostly all farmers. So again, I have to relate things around that as well. Families have their own ideas when they come to intervention. Sometimes, no, my kid's not mental. He just needs to come home and work. So, I mean, it depends on the relationship. It depends on the current situation. But interventions, it's difficult because it's not that much out there.
That's funny you say that because I was talking. I'm from the Atlantic City area in New Jersey. And our union president there from Atlantic City, he talked about how he runs the in-school suspension, but he's changed the name to responsible thinking class. And the shift that just that made, mm-hmm. when he called home and told parents that their child was going to spend a couple days in a responsible thinking class versus in-school suspension, they said, oh, that's just what he needs.
Right.
That's exactly what he needs. He needs to think about things more responsible. And versus when it was presented as in-school suspension, the negative feelings that people had towards that. And, you know, so much of our outside culture that we're attaching to it and how we talk to parents and the way it's perceived comes with that. So how do we change the thinking and bring it from, you know, because we were just talking before that this is a fine line between saying that this is something that's really important and we don't want to make it feel stigmatized, but also not softening it so much that people think it's fluffy and that this is just wellness and, well, isn't that sweet and kind of a 70s hippie thing that maybe wouldn't it be nice if all these districts did, but non-essential. So how do you walk that line and make people see it as an essential piece, but not a punitive piece or a negative?
I think that when James talked about getting rid of the stigma around mm-hmm. mental health, that's how we change it, right? And I think what we need to make sure that we destigmatize it both for educators and across the education system, but also for parents and for the community. Because when you are not reacting in a crisis, and when you have that discussion and that dialogue ahead of time, then people can all come to the table. It's like, I'm gonna pick a pretty sad subject, teen youth suicide. If the time when you deal with teen suicide is when your school building in your community has a heavy occurrence of teen youth suicides, that becomes more of a finger pointing or a stigma. I don't want to say finger pointing, but it does, an identifiable way of dealing with it, rather than proactively making sure that your community understands that teen youth suicide is an epidemic. Opioid addiction is an epidemic. Mm-hmm. You need to have those conversations in the safety of it not being in a crisis, in a spot where it becomes proactive rather than reactive. And I think that that's what you're talking with the mental health first aid, right? Mm-hmm. We go and do those programs before it's an identified issue. Because if it's an identified issue in a school system, then the families and the children become the identified culprits, victims, issue, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
The issue.
Could we maybe take a turn and answer some questions? I know we have one in the back, so we'll start there and then work our way forward. We have a microphone.
I could probably bellow loud enough.
You're welcome to try. I'll hear you.
Thank you very much. First up, thank you to the panelists for being here. We appreciate your taking your time out.
Yeah.
Thank you. I'm not an educator, but I am a leader of a nonprofit, funder, and an active partner focused on integrated wellness in Northern Arizona. And we've run into an interesting challenge, and I would love to get the panel's suggestions on how to deal with a slightly different constituency than you've talked about, and that is school boards. We were approached by a district that is high poverty, almost 100% exposure to violent, domestic violence, guns on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. And we co-designed a program with them on mindfulness, basically breathing techniques, things that were proven out in West Baltimore and some of the excellent case studies. We funded the program for them. We offered them the money to pay for a 25-plus year special ed teacher and a half-time, so 20 hours a week, licensed therapist. And the idea was, instead of kids being sent to the principal's office, they would be sent to the mindfulness room, where we also loaded it up with all kinds of technology that they could use, as well as, you know, music, all kinds of things. We set up, the idea was to also have a parent support group that would meet twice a month, targeted to students who were sent to the mindfulness room to give them specific tips on how to work with their kids rather than having them come in and meet with the principal. And then also teaching mindfulness for 5 to 10 minutes every day in every classroom. We thought this would be a really outstanding program. Faculty got 100% behind it. School administration got 100% behind it. And then the school board said, we can't do it because we're afraid of public reaction. Yeah. We presented the data to them, as you were talking about, Amy, in terms of the connection between suspension and incarceration, which is substantial. And this would have been a replicable model that we could take beyond the borders of Arizona. And we really thought this was a great program. Even changing names wasn't good enough. We couldn't rebrand it in a way that they found acceptable. I'm wondering if you have encountered any of those problems and how you might suggest that we deal with a school district, a school board rather, that just doesn't have the courage to put this program in, despite the fact that you've repeatedly demonstrated with data and evidence how beneficial it would be to the kids. Thank you.
Well, first, I'm sure everybody on our panel wants your name. As soon as you said funder, that's like bells going off. We all want your name. And just, you know, this is a question that I think Kennedy Forum, we've talked about too, with where is that, because obviously screening, we talk about wanting screening for children at key transitions. And what would be the reaction if we asked parents to get a screening for concussion baseline? You know, if we said your son or daughter is going to go play a sport, you want to make sure their brain is safe and we're able to do this for just in case they get a concussion. They'd probably be okay with that and receptive to it. If we said, you know, your child is an athlete, so let's teach them breathing techniques for that. Let's teach them visualization techniques, right? Swimmers picture themselves winning the race. And we're teaching them all these things for their athletic performance. Then are they comfortable with it? Probably so. If we're saying it's for their academic performance. But if it's under the bracket of mental health, then we see a paradigm shift there. So, did anybody on the panel want to respond to maybe how you...
Just to piggyback again, it's the stigma of mental health. By me being in a small district, it's easy to say that we have to grow up from the mind state of acknowledging Uncle Clarence. We got to take him out the closet now. He's been in the closet for so many years because we want to keep him away from family functions. We got to get off that mentality now. And as soon as the community, as soon as each individual family can overcome that, then we can take it to a broader range with the school district. Speaking of my school district, that would be embarrassing for them. So yes, I'm with you as far as the argument. It would be embarrassing. It would definitely be embarrassing. They probably would not support it because now it became a mental school. It became a mental program now. And the last thing the school want to do is be identified as being the bad school or the school that has all the mental issues.
Like I did with the mental health first aid in my district, I kept asking people. I didn't bug them. I didn't do it so much that they didn't want to hear about it anymore. When I saw new people, I would make connections. I would bring it up. If they were interested, I would pursue it further. A lot of them weren't, and I just kept doing it until I found some allies, and then I had to build the base from there. with finding one, you know, maybe one parent that's on board with it, because that school board, I'm assuming, has to answer to the parents. And if enough, you get enough parents on board, then they have no choice but to listen. But it was, you know, and then it starts a snowball effect when you find that one ally, and then they have a friend, and then you start building up that base. And unfortunately, it took a while to get it done, but we got it done.
Sounds like you need the support of the PTA to come out and
I was going to say that, you know, the power of the parent voice is very, very important, and I really am going to put that. Parents care about every bit as much about the academic achievement as their kids, their safety and well-being. And really, if you can log into that network of parent and community members who care about safety and well-being, and you talk about it in the broad sense, you're going to leverage some change. I've seen PTAs, and it's not PTAs, I've seen parent groups, I'll say PTAs out there around an issue, whether it is LGBTQ, whether it's around teen youth suicide, whether it's around drinking and graduation parties, they are caring about those safety and health issues. And so when you engage the community and they start asking their school district about where this is and why it's not here, when you start talking about absenteeism, which is an offshoot of in-school and out-of-school suspensions, kids don't learn when they're not in school. And so when you start twisting that, they're not in the classroom, they're not learning, we need a time, I don't want to say timeout, but a timeout situation that's short and is mindful and gets them back in the classroom and learning, you just have to creatively leverage that parent and community force that we need to fix this.
I think those are two really great suggestions, getting them engaged and maybe talking about the anxiety levels students are facing today with the demands of testing, how this is a performance enhancer, and that this is a part of hygiene, mental health hygiene, just like they're learning in health class, that this could be embedded into that as well. I know we have at least two other questions, so maybe we can, we're good, okay.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much to the panelists for sharing your personal stories as well as it bridged into, you know, where you are today. I'm also from New Jersey. And New Jersey, being very innovative and creative, has created a system of care for children that began about 18 years ago. Disappointment is I don't think we really jumped in full way that we should have. I'm at the end of my career, not the beginning. I've been doing this for 36 years. And I'm going to put a little twist on your pattern of a woman, strong woman behind a man, although I do believe that. My wife is a very strong figure, and I admire and respect her work greatly. I am also the reason she got in the field. I just had to throw that part out.
Right,
but the piece is that it's not about a woman influencing a man. It's about a person influencing another person. And that leads into the whole idea of that what I'm going to mention here is there's an initiative, which I am just absolutely surprised that it hasn't just taken off full force. Because to me, I'm old enough to know there is not an easy answer. However, if there is magic, it is what I have seen in this. And yet it's ignored, and I don't understand that. It's called wraparound. That's the principle. And it really stems after the old domain model, and it stems after old child family therapy, which got lost somewhere. If you ever want to read something that talks about a unified effort to work with a family, read Carl Whitaker's Family Crucible. Written years ago, he was my hero. He would not ever work with an individual, ever. Any working with an individual child, to me, is completely against any sort of progress you'll ever make. They don't live alone. They're not influenced alone. None of us exist without some kind of assistance. And if you look online, you'll see the wraparound initiative. You'll see there is a national wraparound initiative. And basically what it is it's building a domain around the family. But I think we should extend that practice to a wraparound initiative that is in our local communities and it is in our state hierarchy and then extends out to our federal government that says there has to be that whole unified effort of people coming to the table. What Doris was speaking about this morning, about Lincoln bringing in, you know, people and Johnson talking about, I'd rather have people inside the tent. If you look at an IEP and if you look at the child study teams, no matter what you say, they're exclusive. They need to get something done, and the least people that are at that table, the better they like it. However, it's a short fix, not a long one. It's not going to solve. They don't have a go-to person after they're done. I'm suggesting that all these problems, even the gentleman in the back talking about the school board, if everybody's around this, you find a way to get through that school board and bring them in for the meetings that are going to be part of what this is. So it's an opportunity for me to say this to a large group and a national group. This initiative has been in New Jersey for a long time. We have 15 of the organizations throughout our state that do what my agency does, which is to create this wraparound process for children. I can't do anything without the team members and my staff. I'm nothing as a CEO without the people I go to for expertise. It's the same system. Team is so important, especially now when we're so siloed and divided in whether it's race or whether it's culture or whether it's politics. I mean, we've shifted, you know, many hated the last president, now many hate this president. Is that really so different? I mean, you're gonna justify, you know, your stance. It still divides us, no matter what anybody says, it's a divide, and we all are beginning to realize that this is not a good idea. And that may be the revelation of this new political realm, is it's saying we can't be so divided. Maybe. Anyway, that's my pitch.
Tell us your organization.
I'd like to say about that.
No, tell us your organization.
My organization is Bergen's Promise, and we're in Bergen County, New Jersey.
Thank you.
And you have one in your county. You have Cape May Atlantic, and they're very good. One of the CMOs, run by Alan DeStefano, is a very good organization. I suggest you reach out to him. Good guy, and it's a good place.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to
Thank
all my
you.
Battle.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
I think you see, I don't know if I'm on. I think you see, my battery might be down.
Okay. Do you want to?
I'll talk really loud. I think you see the wraparound model when you see incidents at schools like school shootings, or you see teen youth suicide at a high rate. You see that wraparound model for a while. Sometimes it's long term. I serve, my president-elect is from Connecticut, and he lives close to the Sandy Hook neighborhood, and there's still some wraparound supports going on in that community. So I think you see that wraparound model work in extreme situations, and you see them work in some schools where they do have a wraparound model for providing services. But you're right, we could do better as a society with a large systemic wraparound model.
All right. Well, I think we'll be up here if there are questions we didn't get to, but everybody's moving to their next panel. So thank you so much.